MCCLA. Welcome to the live broadcast of Metropolitan Community Church, Los Angeles.
Please join with me in the words of the call to worship, which are a leader and people response. We gather to worship the one who crafted creation out of chaos. Our cries of joy join the anthems of the universe. We gather to lift our praise to the God who gives us voice. We bring the songs which have echoed in our hearts all week long. We gather as the children of God, our joy unbroken in God's love. Young and old, tone deaf and perfect pitched, lift the woo songs of faith. We worship you, God. Amen. Let us therefore lift our toned deaf voices and those with perfect pitch in our opening song. Almighty and loving God, you who demonstrate yourself to us in so many different and new ways, we welcome you this morning as we welcome one another. We allow the Spirit of the living God to be within us, around us, and to fall afresh on us. So may the Holy Spirit bless us this morning as we worship in truth and in spirit, And in that spirit, may we therefore go into the world to allow the world to see you made manifest in our lives and through our very actions. May the Spirit of the Living One therefore rejoice with us, for this is the day that our God has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you this morning. It really is a joy to welcome you to worship as we gather one with the other for fellowship and for worship, to join with the living saints of who God represents in the world today through you and me. Welcome to you. We want to welcome you, especially if you are worshiping with us for the very first time this morning. We know that you have a choice in worshiping communities, but we are delighted that you're present with us today. I wonder if you would indulge my spirit. I wonder if you are with us for the very first time today. I wonder if you would just raise your hand and keep it up for a moment so that we can see you, so that we can welcome you to worship this morning. We do extend our greetings and love to one another. Let's welcome one another in Jesus' name this morning. We also want to welcome especially those amongst us who see ourselves as mothers. We know in this congregation that mothers come in so many different forms and in very many different genders and gender identities. The mothering spirit is not just contained within the feminine, but the feminine within each and every one of us. But we also acknowledge that there are some folks amongst us who are mothers biologically or who are parenting today. And so we want to acknowledge you this morning. So if you recognize yourself as a mother with a mothering spirit and you would like to be acknowledged, then please just raise your hand so that we can thank you for being a mother to us all. That's why we call ourselves radically inclusive in this church. It really is a joy to welcome you and to thank you for offering your gift to us as a mother. As you came in this morning, our ushers would have given you your orders of worship, and inside you will find the announcements for today and for the upcoming weeks. We say this every Sunday, but it really is true. We are an extremely busy congregation. Many, many things happen during the week and on Sundays within our church and within our community. And not everything that happens within our church can be announced from the pulpit. So we really do invite you and encourage you to not only look at the announcements in the orders of worship, but to take your orders of worship home and to mark on your own calendars the things that you would like to participate in and to be a part of this living and dynamic community. There are a few things that we do wish to bring to your attention, however, and they will be on the screens, and I'll announce them also this morning. Azania, who are our ministry to people of African descent, are gathering this morning twice. They're gathering for coffee time after the 9 o'clock service this morning. If you would like to know more information about our ministry to people of African descent, please do meet with Azania after the 9 o'clock service. And then after the 11 o'clock service, they'll be meeting in the upper room above the fellowship hall for their regular monthly meetings. So we want to encourage you to either stop by after worship this morning or to come back after the 11 o'clock service. The ushers are now passing out the welcome tablets, so please do make sure that you check in for us this morning. It really is important that we know that you've been present, so please do take that moment. LA Pride is coming up, and we want to encourage you to demonstrate your pride in Metropolitan Community Church of Los Angeles. MCCLA, really proud of it, and we will be marching on Pride Sunday, which is June the 10th at Santa Monica Boulevard. So if you would like more information about Pride this year and how you can participate, please see Manuel. He's our head usher at the 11 o'clock service, and he'll be available hopefully after the 9 o'clock, or you can see Reverend Dr. Pat this morning, and she'll be glad to put you in touch with Manuel in this coming week. Today is Brown Bag Sunday, and we will be making sandwiches for those less fortunate than ourselves, or putting brown sack lunches together, and they'll be gathering after the 9 o'clock service in the lobby, so please do help to put those bags together directly after worship. A Tribe, which is our young adults group, are putting together an LGBT youth talent show coming up on Friday, May the 25th. Tryouts are tomorrow, May the 14th at 6 o'clock. Now, I do not believe that you have to be a youth, but I guess we can all be young in spirit. So if you would like to try out, please do come tomorrow evening at 6 o'clock and try out for the LGBT youth talent show that we'll be hosting here in our congregation. Wednesday evenings are an opportunity for us to be refreshed during the middle of the week, and we begin at 6:30 every Wednesday with a time of meditation and prayer. It really is a very beautiful service. If you've not been, we encourage you to do so. It's all mainly in candlelight, and an opportunity to light candles and to be in a time of prayer and meditation. It's at 6:30 on Wednesday evenings, and then of course after our after our Teze service, there are two things that happen in our church. We have our choir practice, and we also have our Bible study. Bible study currently is looking at the cycle of life in 30 days, and we are moving through those 30 days, and this coming Wednesday we'll be looking at giving birth and mothering our dreams. How appropriate for Mother's Week. So Reverend Dr. Pat Langlois will be sharing that with us, giving birth and mothering our dreams. On Wednesday, May the 23rd, Azania and many other communities are sponsoring and a showing of On These Shoulders We Stand. Some of you may have seen that, but we want to encourage you to come out. It's at Jules Catch One Nightclub, which is down on Pico. Pamela is here this morning, and she'll be happy to give you more information about that in the lobby following worship this morning. But they are honoring Jewel specifically. Some of you in the African American community may know Jewel. She's also very well known in our community. She has been working specifically with LGBT people and most definitely with people who have been living with HIV and AIDS. And she will be honored on that evening. So we want to encourage you. At 5:30 for refreshments and 6 o'clock for the screening with questions and answers. And again, it's co-sponsored by Azania, and Pamela is here, and she'll be here to let you know more about that after worship this morning. I want to give a very special shout out and thanks to all those who help with our ministry to the homeless in our community, specifically to the two food drives that we recently had. One was with Darcel, who just did an amazing job with the post office, donated 1,000 pounds of food to our food pantry here in our congregation, which was just an amazing job. Please, let's thank Darcy for that. And then on Friday, when we were over at our Prospect campus, we saw food arrive from a food drive that Keller Williams, one of the local real estate agents in the Los Feliz district, donated bags and bags and bags and bags and bags and bags and bags of food for our HopeNet. And on Saturday, when the families showed up for their food, there was more than abundance for our families. We fed more than 80 families yesterday who were able to take home shopping from our food pantries. So to Art and to his partner and to all those who volunteer for HopeNet, please let's show our appreciation to them as well. A lot has been happening this week, specifically over in our Prospect campus, and we are looking forward to our first worship service there. We will be leaving this building on Sunday the 27th. That'll be our last service in this building. And then we'll be gathering for our first services in our new building on Sunday the 3rd of June for 9 o'clock, 11 o'clock, and of course for 1:30. I want to remind you that parking is available. It's at least within a couple of blocks of the building. We have two parking lots that are specifically for us. Please make sure that you check out the parking lots. They are, I believe they're in our orders, they'll be in our orders of worship next week, but we'll make sure that people are well versed on where that parking is. And for those of you who need to park closer to the building, we'll make sure that there is some parking available tandem parking on site. But if you are able to drop people off and then go and park, please do so. That will make things much, much easier in that neighborhood. But parking lots are available, so please don't use that as an excuse not to come to church. And the Red Line is just a couple of stops away. God bless you. We are in the right place this morning. I believe that God is with us. I believe that we're in for some wonderful worship this morning. And we do that by allowing the Spirit to be free in each and every one of us. So let's turn to one another now and offer a sign of peace and welcome. God is with us and God is with you. God bless you.
The scripture reading this morning comes from 1 John chapter 5, verses 1 through 6. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves the God loves their child as well. This is how we know that we love the children of God, by loving God and carrying out God's commandments. In fact, this is love for God, to keep the commands. And these commands are not burdensome, for everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. He did not come by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. Hear what the Spirit says today.
Please be seated, and please join with me in a word of prayer this morning. Abundant and gracious and living and loving and all-serving God, thank you. Thank you for this moment. Thank you for this time. Thank you for this community. Thank you for being with us this morning. And it is in that spirit that we come with openness and love and joy, not only to welcome you, but to hear you and to respond to you. And so we ask, O God, that you would now still our hearts and open our minds so that we may be present with you, to hear what the Spirit says to us this day. And in that, may we not only hear, but live and do as you would have us do. And so, Almighty God, and now I pray that you would touch my lips of clay, mold them into the words that need to be spoken this day. And may the words that come from my mouth and the meditations on each and every one of our hearts, may they be acceptable to you, in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, when I was growing up, I had many surrogate mums, many folks who were nurturing and loving and who came alongside me and helped me to form into the adult that I am. I'm really grateful to those mothering spirits. And, you know, I said at the very beginning, sometimes they came in the shape of women and sometimes they came in the shape of men. That mothering spirit that comes amongst us. One of those women was a woman called Jenny Donovan. Now, she is a cropodist in the UK, and just a few weeks ago when I was back there, I went to visit her and to just check in with her and see how she was doing. It was a joy to be able to listen and speak to her and to just kind of catch up. But the reason why I know Jenny so well is that when I was going through seminary, Jenny was one of my committee that would sit with me. And those of us who have been through that process know that we usually have a company of folks who gather with us. They're usually from the congregation, and they help us to discern what it means not only to be a pastor, but to be a leader, and not only to discern that, but also to acknowledge that this is a shared partnership that we do. It's not all about clergy. It's about us all working together in this community. Well, she worked with me for those many years. And, you know, remember, I was like 18 years of age when I went to seminary. And so, you know, as an 18-year-old, I think I thought I knew it all. I believed that, you know, I had the truth and my job was to impart that truth upon people. And she was really good at being very gentle with me, of helping me to understand that, you know, I only have a piece of the truth. And that the truth is really when we embody it as the church and as the body of Christ. And so when I finished seminary, I was 22 and I was getting ready to be ordained, she took me out for coffee. And she took me out for coffee for a specific reason. And she took me out for coffee because she wanted to ensure that I was prepared to be a pastor. And she felt that this was her last piece of her responsibility. Now, of course, it wasn't, because even to today, we're still in constant contact with one another. But she sat with me and she said, you know, Neil, she said, I just want to give you a perspective from the congregation that I think is something that you will take with you into the rest of your life. And she said, I just want you to know that you've done this theological education. And, you know, I know that you're brain smart and I know that you're going to, you know, be, everything's going to be up here and you're going to be ready to kind of launch that out into the world. She said, I just want to say to you one thing, kiss. Kiss. She said, I just want you to acknowledge that when you get up to preach on Sunday mornings, that you remember kiss. Keep it simple, stupid. And she said to me, she said, I honestly want you to remember that. She said, because when people get these theological ideas and these theological education, that sometimes people can preach and it has no relationship to the people in the pew. She said, it just all sounds so wonderful and so lovely, but if there's nothing practical, if there's nothing that I can take home with me, if there's nothing that I can take into my week with me, you can just speak for 10 or 15 minutes and it means absolutely nothing. She said, keep it simple. And I tell you, I want to be honest with you, that has been something that every time I try to get up to preach, it's the thing that I hold dear into my heart. She never knew, I don't think, and perhaps she did, the impact that she continues to have upon me and upon my life and upon the efforts that I try to do whenever I get up to preach. I think Jesus kept it simple. I think that the whole ministry of Jesus' life was enabling us to kiss, to keep it simple, to remind ourselves that all of these theories and laws and dogma are just that, and that Jesus came to help us to have a relationship with God that was simple, to keep it simple. In the reading this morning, I think that we had a message of keeping it simple. The message said to us that in order for us to be children of God, we must keep God's commands. That in order for us to know that we are right with God, we must keep God's commands. And those commands are summed up in Jesus himself when Jesus says to us that the thing that we are called to do in following God's commands is to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second command is like this, to love our neighbor in the same way that we love ourselves. On this hangs all the law of the prophets. It's not about the Ten Commandments anymore. It's about these new commandments that Jesus gives to us. I actually believe that if you follow those two commandments, you can't break any of the other ones. But the reality is that all of the things that we have done to try to avoid being in relationship with God, Jesus came to keep it simple, to follow God's commands, to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love our neighbor to the same degree that we love ourselves. Now, do you hear that significance that's given to us? To love our neighbor to the same degree that we love ourselves. That truly means, friends, that we must truly love ourselves in order to love one another. I've thought about that command recently, about the way in which we really do love ourselves. And quite honestly, I think in our world today, if we are really loving our neighbor to the same degree that we're loving ourselves, I have to ask, are we really loving our neighbor at all? When you see the way in which we act toward one another, we have to ask ourselves, is that really the way that we would act towards ourselves? This week, just this week, listening to some of the political stuff that's going on in our world. Now, there were two events in our world this week that were, one was good and, well, the other one was perhaps not so good. On Tuesday, we heard of North Carolina and the vote that they made to put the Amendment 1 into their constitution, which basically reaffirmed that marriage in the state of North Carolina will only be recognized between one man and one woman. and that LGBT people would not be given the right to marry in North Carolina. Now, of course, on Wednesday, President Obama, the first sitting president in the United States of America, finally evolved in his understanding of marriage. I love the way that we evolve as people. You know, I think that President Obama was very true in his statement that he has evolved to his understanding about marriage. And for the first time, a sitting president in our country said that he truly believed that lesbians and gay men should have the right to marry in the United States of America. I think that's a tremendous statement. The United Church of Christ, of which he's a member, said he's finally caught up with church practice and with church law. And I'm so glad that the church actually said something positive. Now, of course, we know that there are two sides to this argument, and as a community, we try to bridge that gap and to help everyone come to an understanding of full equality for all people. But I truly believe that that is what Jesus was trying to give to us. This understanding that in order to love our neighbor, in order to fully extend the love of God to one another, we must accept the love that God has for us, and that we must accept love for ourselves. That truly, when we love ourselves, we have nothing to fear from the world. That when we love ourselves, when we truly embody who we are, we have nothing to fear from somebody else. We have nothing to fear from someone else's faith, someone else's religion, someone else's race or gender identity, or even the person that they love. We have nothing to fear but fear itself. And the whole message of Jesus is not about just reaching out and ignoring yourself. It's about loving yourself, because when you love yourself, then it makes it so much easier to give love to one another. So much easier to pour that love out into somebody else. But if you don't have love in the first place, then what is it that we are pouring out into the world? I sometimes think that when we hate ourselves, we think we are giving out love, but we're giving out something less than love. We're giving out our own fears, our own phobias, our own misunderstanding of who God is, because the message is keep it simple. That in order to truly love God, to truly love your neighbor, you must love yourself. And what a message that Jesus gave, so simple, so clear, and yet how we have misinterpreted it over the years. Jesus says that we are come to overcome the world, to overcome the world's fears, to overcome the world's prejudices, and that we do that by knowing God. And we know God because God is love, and love is God. You know, I wish that we could just preach that message over and over and over and over again until every single one of us got it into our heads. That in order to truly be in the world, to truly overcome what the world has done and continues to do, we must exhibit love for ourselves and therefore love for the world. It's so much more honorable when we see people reaching out from a genuine place of love, from a genuine place of care, from a genuine place of concern. And I see that in this congregation over and over and over again. I see folks in this congregation who are genuinely giving, not because they think that that's the only way to get a reward into heaven, but truly giving because they have come to that notion and understanding that in order to be of service in the world, we must love ourselves first. I think, Darcy, that's what you did when you decided that it was time to reach out and bring in more food for those who are less fortunate than ourselves. You didn't do it so that I would stand up here this morning and give you a round of applause. I truly believe that art, and when you go over to HopeNet on a Friday and you unpack all of those bags, that you did it because you did it selflessly, just from that pure love for someone else. And Gail, when you packed up your big truck yesterday, and I saw that truck filled with all sorts of things, I wasn't sure exactly what was in there because there's things there that I would never know. But things that were in your truck. And you went over to our new campus and you spent an hour or so just looking at the facilities and how you might be able to help with your skills to make it a little better. You did that not so that I would use you in my sermon this morning. Because I know that, yeah, you did. I'm so glad that we can be truthful in this congregation. Friends, love ourselves. Because when we love ourselves, we can laugh, we can smile, we can have joy in our spirit, and others will be attracted to the God that is in us. The God who is having fun with us this morning. I'm tired of churches that make us want to feel bad about ourselves. When we have a God who keeps it simple and says we've come to overcome the world, to overcome the world and all of its stress and all of its rules and all of its regulations and all of the ways in which it tries to divide us up and come to a world where truly we have nothing to fear from one another because love is in our hearts. I invite us this morning to continue to be of service, to continue to pour out that love from into and through one another, because I truly believe that it is in that love that we manifest God into the world, that we manifest joy, and we manifest hope. May that be the simple message of radical, progressive Christianity that enables us to feel good about the God who is with us. And in that, the world will know. The world will know God. May we be blessed this morning more abundantly than we were blessed before we came in. And in that abundance of our blessing this morning, regardless of our circumstances, and we all know that we have circumstances that we have to deal with, but may we feel blessed this morning so that we might give that blessing to another. And so it is when we keep it simple, stupid. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for being overcomers of the world and all that it tries to impart upon us to divide and conquer rather than bring and unite with love. And so may we hear your message this morning, keeping it simple, that we manifest God in the world when we keep God's commandments, to love you with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love our neighbor in the same way that you have called us to love ourselves. May we bathe in that love this morning, and from that place of love, may we therefore love one another. On this hangs all the law of the prophets. In Jesus' name, amen.
Accept each other as Christ accepted us. cropotist. Does anybody know what cropotist means? Okay. Thank you so much, Reverend Neil. I was really perplexed about that. Okay. We're excited here. We're very excited because we're moving to a new building. And as I've been told, it's beautiful. And I cannot wait to get there. But sisters and brothers, we know that your tithes and your offerings helped make that possible. Really, really. So when we're in that new building, you can say, ah, so this is what the collection plate is all about. You know, we have so many ministries that come out of our church, and there's going to be so many more as time goes. Tithes and offerings also pay for that. It pays for the justice that we stand behind as we move forward in our ministries. It stands for the rights of all people, whether they be gay or whether they be straight. Our pastors and our congregants work hard for social justice. Because you see, they, like we, know it's the right thing to do. So please give as you can in your tithes and offerings today. Thank you.
To give, and that's to give of our hearts. For when we are with one another in prayer, we give of ourselves, we open ourselves to that vulnerability to allow God to be fully and completely present with us. So I'm going to invite us, friends, to go to God in prayer in preparation for this feast. Beloved community, we are called to this table, that was set for each and every one of us. I invite us to hear our mother calling us to the table. Come on, dinner's ready.
That's it.
That mother can be the voice of the one who raised us, could be the one who gave birth to us. And for some of us, that's not the same person. It can be the voice of a grandmother, a sister, even a brother or an uncle. But hear that voice calling you to the table, to the feast. For some of us, those feasts weren't pleasant, but this one is. Because I also invite us to hear the voice of our mother in God, calling out to her children, "I have prepared a feast. Come and eat."
Yes.
Mary called that out to her son Jesus. "Come on, son, come to the table. It's prepared for you." And he learned his lessons well from his mother. And yes, his father too. From his mother, I like to think that he learned to give of his heart to bring all the children together. And so as we come to this table, I lift up all of those who are and were mothers to each
yes.
of us.
Yes.
For a number of us, our mothers are no longer with us in physical form. And for them, we share special, special prayers. And I ask that if for those in here who have lost their mother, from this physical realm, to feel her arms around them.
Mm-hmm.
And hear, "I love you.
That's it.
I am proud of you. I'm glad you're in the house of God this morning."
Yes.
For those of us whose mothers are still in this realm, may we come to a newer appreciation, even in their faults.
Mm-hmm.
And for those of us who are mothers, caring for the children of the world, special strength and gratitude for the best job and the hardest job ever loved. Friends, all of us indeed, mother the world, for the presence of Christ is within each and every one of us. And when we hear and feel his compassion, when we live that compassion, that caring, that guidance, we mother the world. So on this beautiful day, mixed emotions, let today be one filled with the love of our God and the love of one another. So may indeed we be prepared for this table given freely, given in love. And may we join with Mary's son in the words of prayer given to us.
Amen.
Forgive us our debts as we into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine
is the dominion and the power and the glory forever.
Beautiful music, every note perfect, joining together in graceful harmony. This is what we imagine our lives to be. Our choir already is. Yes. Yet sometimes our love is flat, our anger often sharp, and in a moment of brief silence, I ask that we confess how sometimes we struggle to keep in harmony with God, to keep that measured beat with God's life-giving melody in our lives. So friends, let us join together in a moment of silence as we go to God in prayer. And together we share.
Sing to us, conductor of grace. Sing of your forgiveness, your hope, your love for us. Strike a chord of humility in our hearts so our eyes could see all you have done for us. And in seeing, we might believe how much you love us. And in believing, we would echo that new song of hope and life composed through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Friends, listen to the melody of the good news. Christ is risen, bringing joy into the world. The one who was dead now lives and wraps us in delight of life forever in the presence of God. Now our dirges have turned to joy. Our requiem has been rearranged as a hymn of celebration and hope. Our laments are lost in a cantata of praise. Amen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Amen.
Amen. Amen. As much as we are loved by our God,
so we are to love one another.
Beloved of God, come to this table with our hearts wide open.
God promised to dwell in us.
Here at the table of wonder and grace, we are fed by the one who loves us.
Though we have never seen God, we know and testify to the one who gives us all we need.
So with those who have gone down to the dust, and with all the generations yet to come, we join our voices singing your praises.
Santo, 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 mi corazón te adora, mi corazón te sabe decir. Holy, 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 my heart adores you. My heart knows how to say to you, holy are you, God.
As we remember his life, death and resurrection, as we seek to follow his command to love, we sing of that mystery we call faith. For on the night that Jesus was to be taken from us, he gathered with his disciples, taking bread from the table, He blessed it. He broke it. He said, "This is my body given for you. Eat of it in remembrance of me."
Yes.
And likewise, following the supper, he took from the table a cup. Some say the cup of Elijah, the prophet. He blessed it and offered thanks, saying, "Drink of this, all of you, and in doing so, remember me."
My friends, let us once again join our hearts in prayer. Precious, precious Creator, our Mother, Father God, pour out your joyful spirit upon the gifts of this bread and cup, and upon your children gathered here at your feast. We would open our hearts to receive the bread of life, not with silenced gratitude, but with glad songs of joy. We would empty ourselves to be filled with the cup's compassion, not with speechless thanks, but with shouts of praise. As we learn the new song of sacrifice on behalf of others, we would go to serve the brokenhearted. As we are given the instruments of praise, we would turn them into the means to transform the lives of the hungry, the homeless, the forgotten, the outcast. And when our music has ended and there is only the plain song of life forever and the tender embrace of your peace, we will gather at the table once again, hands and hearts, brothers and sisters, joining in the never-ending praise to you, God in community, holy in one. Amen.
I've got some good news. That good news is that MCCLA and MCCs all around the world celebrate an open communion. That means you don't have to be a member of this church or of any church. The ushers will guide you forward to the stations and we will take elements dipped in non-alcoholic grape juice and place it upon your tongue. Or you may take the elements and dip in the grape juice yourself. We'll then provide you with a short blessing. And if you want one or the other, just let us know. If you want a private communion, there will be a station of consecrated elements in the alcove where you can go at any time. This is just a time of prayer and reflection. We just ask that you follow the direction of the ushers. Will the acolytes and servers come at this time?
Amen.
rising sun.
Together on our knees.
So last week, the word was fertilizer. This week, the word is chiropodist. We are all learning something together in this church.
Hallelujah.
Now, I know it's a foot doctor.
We thought it was crotchety.
I'm never saying a word again. So, friends, let us keep it simple.
Silly.
May God allow us to love ourselves.
Yes.
Because it is from that place that we exhibit the genuine love of God. Let's rise in body and spirit as we close worship.
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. It sounds like a music to my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, whose love has first found me. It tells my Savior's love for all. Christ died to set us free. Whatever problems may befall, we'll live in dignity. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, whose love has first found me. It bids me serve amid the wrath God's people face each day, and sheds along life's troubled path bright sunshine on my way. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, whose love has first found me.
Now unto God's gracious mercy and protection each and every one of us is given, and the blessing of God, known as Creator, Savior, and Holy Spirit, be with us and remain with us, now and evermore. Amen. Go in peace.
Thank you for joining us today. By participating with us online, you are an extension of this church's membership ministry, our extended fellowship. Whether you're tuning in from Los Angeles, London, Tokyo, or Zimbabwe, wherever you are in the world, we are so excited to embrace you, to hear from you, and to pray for you. All of the people you've just seen in this broadcast, not just the ministers and the choir, but every person sitting on those pews, we are here for you. So please, why don't you connect with us? interact with us. We have four ways you can do that: telephone, email, Facebook, and Twitter. And all of those links are located at the bottom of every webpage of our website at mccla.org. With your help, we can not just continue, but expand and reach a greater number of people with God's love through this ministry. Be a video angel amongst us by supporting this ministry through our donate link, located just under the support menu in the upper right corner of any page of our website. Your participation is very important. And I want to invite you to write to me and let me know how I can be in prayer and praise with you. Even though you are not here in our worship center, you are still a part of MCCLA. Email me directly at revneal@mccla.org. May God bless your life. And I look forward to welcoming you back many, many times to MCCLA and our weekly live broadcast. You are